Welcome back to CryptosRUs. I'm George. We're all George. So, happy Saturday. We're a few days away from 4th of July, so a lot of people are traveling right now. There's a lot of barbecues, vacations, whatnot. But today I'm here with you guys talking about Bitcoin and markets. Are they going to get better? Are they going to get better or worse? So let's talk about what's going on in the world of crypto and everything else that's going on. So smash the like, subscribe to the channel, make sure you hit that notification bell to get notified of all my streams. Follow me on social media, check out CryptosRUs.com, and make sure you follow the brand new CryptosRUs Clips channel. Welcome, guys. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Hopefully you guys are doing something this weekend, this long weekend. Probably going to have very low volume this weekend, so I don't expect any big moves. Although, with low volume, sometimes you do get some volatility, right? But right now, we're about the same as yesterday. Overall, we're stuck right around 19,300. We haven't seen any moves recently. But what is going on today? Well, there's a lot of stuff going on, including yesterday. A lot of big stuff going on yesterday. I'll get to that. But I was looking at, you know, what happened to markets on Friday actually turned out to be pretty good. U.S. markets ended pretty green overall. And there are some hope. There are some people that actually think that, no, not just some people. According to this, almost every single major U.S. bank thinks that by the end of this year, S&P 500 will not only recover, but many think that it will be at a new high. Yeah, that's how bullish these guys are. I don't know why, but they're all extremely bullish. Not one on this list is anticipating that the economy is going to get worse and that we'll fall deeper in recession and that S&P 500 will be lower. So despite all the negativity out there, I guess, I don't know if we should trust the banks, but every single bank listed here thinks that S&P 500, and if the S&P 500 is going to end higher at the end of the year, most likely NASDAQ and Dow and crypto and everything else will end up higher too. So it's not all doom and gloom, right? So there is hope. But obviously right now, everyone is still fearful about Powell, Lagarde, you know, what are they going to do with rates, inflation, and supply chain doesn't seem to be getting any better. So I saw this headline. Supposedly, IKEA furniture, auto parts, automobiles are delayed severely at European ports, and it will take months upon months for these containers to be sorted out, and many of these are coming to the U.S. So obviously, supply chain issues still exist. Hopefully, over time, as we get to latter half of this year, it clears out and it will reduce some of the inflationary pressures that is attributed to supply chain issues, right? That is why it's impossible to get cars right now still, impossible to get parts, impossible to find IKEA furniture, right? I do see IKEA furniture is being sold above the retail price on eBay and on Facebook and stuff. It's crazy to think that you could actually resell IKEA furniture at this point. And there's many other furniture parts and just, you know, stuff overall that's severely, severely delayed. So, yeah. So hopefully by the end of this year, we're going to get a little bit help from this. Not just from Powell and Lagarde with the rate hikes, but hopefully supply chain issues does calm down a bit and it'll bring down some of the headline inflation that we're seeing right now. But I did also see this. Tesla, for those of you guys that are Tesla fans, they just announced their Q2 numbers, 254,000, which is a 50% increase versus Q2 of 2021, which in itself is amazing if you think about it, right? So they're on track to still deliver more than 1 million cars this year. However, this is coming in a little bit under expectations. Analyst was expecting 256,000. They came 254,000, 2,000 less. So it's not that big of a deal, but it does show that, even though Elon said recently that we're losing billions upon billions of dollars because we have two gigafactories that's not really being utilized, and the Shanghai one is closed down because of COVID and all that, Tesla is still delivering and still growing at a 50% rate right now year over year, which is really amazing despite everything else that's going on. So just thought I'd bring that up. Just imagine when there is no more supply chain issues and their gigafactories, all three of them, are running at full speed. Man, what is this number going to be at next year or the year after that? It'll be something to witness, something to see. All right, so I want to lead off with some of the macro stuff that's going on. What about crypto stuff? Well, let's start out with the bad. Let's rip off the Band-Aid, start out with all the bad stuff that's going on right now. ThreeArrowsCapital, of course, no surprise, files for Chapter 15. Now, they're filing for Chapter 15 because they're not based in the U.S., but Chapter 15 of Bankruptcy Code will basically block all creditors that wants to file lawsuits and want to recover assets, right? I don't see why this should be granted to them. And I'm sure there's a lot of companies that want to go after ThreeArrowsCapital right now, right? They basically made some very, very poor choices. And a lot of the crypto lending companies also made poor choices by loaning to ThreeArrowsCapital, right? So they should get zero protection, if you ask me. But who knows? So it's not a big surprise. Now, something else that I reported last night that was unfortunately not good, but I have been reminding you guys to safeguard your own crypto, right? Be careful. So Voyager Digital suspends all trading deposit withdrawal, right? So we kind of knew this was happening already. They took a huge, huge loss from ThreeArrowsCapital. They already declared that. They took a huge loan from FTX. So we knew that something like this was going to happen, but still, looking at the comments from my yesterday's video, it seems like people were still caught off guard. Okay, so first of all, watch all my videos. I've been talking about this for 2 weeks now, not just like a few days. I've been talking about for a few weeks now, right? But it's still an unfortunate situation. A lot of people have gotten caught off guard and have all their assets like held in, right? I don't know if they're going to pull out of this. They just released a new PR today. Steven Ehrlich said that it's an extremely difficult decision, but we believe it's the right one. And in this press release, they actually stated how much they have loaned out. So in total, they have $1.1 billion loaned out, with $666 million of that to ThreeArrowsCapital, which is, of course, the major chunk. But even if you subtract them, they still have about $500 million loaned out to counterparties, which they don't disclose who they are, but there's still a lot. There's one major one that has $377 million from the British Virgin Islands. So I don't know what company resides in British Virgin Islands, but that is huge. And the remaining amount, the counterparties are relatively small, so I don't think that's going to be a big issue. But the other big one is this counterparty A, which they have not identified who it is. So that's the latest situation, Voyager. Unfortunately, it is not good. So yeah. As for BlockFi, BlockFi seems to be in a better position, but still there's a lot of fear. Zach Prince basically announced that they are pretty much going to sell to FTX, okay? But not for the ridiculous $25 million that was mentioned prior on CNBC. So basically, they're going to get a $400 million line of credit, bumped up from $250 million before, and there's an option for FTX to sell up to $240 million on top of that to FTX. So in total, it's about $640 million, okay? Not $25 million. So obviously, $640 million is still way off from their previous $3.5 billion valuation, right? But right now, they're still operating. They don't have withdrawals canceled. They don't have anything. They still have their credit card, right? But there's so much fear out there. So that's why to still be careful. So many people got on me saying, oh, how could you talk about this when you have BlockFi as a partner, as a sponsor, you have their logo, right? I've been fair. I've been covering everyone equally as news develops. And right now, BlockFi does seem like they're in a much better position than Voyager and Celsius. But who knows, all right? I'm just going to say that. Who knows? Maybe something else develops. Right now is the time to be safeguarding your own crypto, regardless what platform you're on. It doesn't matter if you're on Coinbase, someone as big as Coinbase or someone as big as Binance, right? Or on BlockFi or on anyone else. Right now, it's just a good idea to be safeguarding your own crypto, right? Because you just don't know what may happen. All right, so that's the latest with BlockFi. It seems like they are going to be selling to FTX for a pretty substantial amount unless there's someone else that comes in, because I think Morgan Creek recently said they want to come in and take this away from FTX. I don't know if that's going to happen at this point. All right, so there's those things, and then there's more things. So yesterday, this was also swirled around on Twitter. There was a few characters, I don't know who they are, and they started spreading rumors that KuCoin was going to be insolvent as well, that they lost massive amounts of Terra, they also lost a lot to ThreeRows Capital, and that they will be shutting down withdrawals soon. So this is all speculation, no proof whatsoever, but it's spread around Twitter like wildfire. Okay, and the CEO came out and said, there's no plans to halt withdrawal, this is utterly ridiculous, and that he may be suing the people that are you know, circling this, right? Again, right now, no one really knows, okay? No one really knows. Just like Steve Ehrlich with Voyager came out a few weeks ago saying, yeah, there's no problem, everything's FDIC insured. Just throwing that out there, you have no worries, right? And look at what happens now. I'm not saying this is going to happen to KuCoin for sure, because I love KuCoin. I use them all the time, right? But with everything that's going on, just be careful. But the CEO is coming out and addressing that they may be going after people that are spreading these rumors, because there's really no evidence of this, but I don't know how you go get evidence of this. Just be careful. All right, so there's that. And I did mention about Coinbase. See, there's a lot of FUD going on, and I'm going to get through it. But overall, what I'm seeing is this. There's so much FUD going on, and some of it legit, but now we're starting to see a lot of FUD that is now just rumor reel, right? Speculation. And it almost seems like this is being done and coordinated on purpose, okay? So it seems like this is all done right now, even though some of these companies may be telling the truth, but no one really believes it anymore, right? So that's the thing. It's like, it's almost like someone like BlackRock or Citadel or FTX, I don't know, one of these bigger guys is like pulling the strings, causing this to happen, trying to get everyone so fearful and to sell out. And then what they're going to do is pounce and buy in everything. And that's how they're going to get much richer when things come up. To me, that's what it sounds like right now. It's like everything is coming out one after another. And I remember in 2018 when we went through the last cycle, in 2018, 2019, it wasn't like this at all. The environment is definitely very different. Now, of course, there's a lot more greed, a lot more money, you know, but still didn't seem like this. But anyways, just want to share some thoughts about that. But Coinbase also has some FUD recently about how they're selling customer data to U.S. federal agencies, including ICE, so that they can track people and where they are. And Coinbase denies this, saying, no, we don't do that. But this is also coming out, right? So this is also part of the FUD I'm talking about. Like, Coinbase seems like, you know, they really get a bad rep. And rightfully so for their customer service. because it sucks. But man, they're getting hammered right now as well, right? There's so much coming out at the same time, and of course, there's Tether. There's Tether FUD too. So Tether, you know, whether or not they're fully backed, we don't know. But after Terra's collapse, after UST collapse, everyone is fearful that Tether will be the next one to collapse. And if Tether collapses, it's going to be way worse than Celsius, Voyager, BlockFi, all put together times 10. It will be absolutely disastrous. So hopefully this is something that never happens. But you know, Tether themselves trying to reassure people by, you know, doing audits. They're reducing the commercial paper by $3.5 billion by the end of this month, which will be half of the commercial paper they have, which is good because commercial paper just basically means it's bonds from companies. And if companies go under, then those bonds become zero, right? So they're trying to do what they can to stop the FUD, right? But like I said, right now, there's just so much swirling around. So, yeah, there's a lot of it. But I just feel like there's too much of it right now. There's just too much of it. And it seems like it's all being done almost, it's like a coordinated FUD right now, right? Like one after another, after another, after another. Like it's meant to like scare the bejesus out of people, get people out, right? And that's when these puppet masters like kind of come in and buy up everything, right? This is what it feels like, especially with what FTX is doing right now. So not to say anything bad about FTX, but it just seems like, I mean, they're trying to just take over the crypto world right now. All right, what else? Well, that's the bad. So there's a lot of bad out there, right? But the good is, We're now seeing a generational buying opportunity for crypto, at least according to Brian Kelly of CNBC, and he is an analyst that goes on CNBC a lot, and he talks about how this is a generational buying opportunity, and we get those opportunities every so often, every few years. Like back in March of 2020, that was definitely a generational buying opportunity, because ETH was under 100, Bitcoin was under 4,000, right? And you could say the end of 2018, same thing. Bitcoin was under 3,000, ETH was, again, under, I think at that point it may have been under $60, right? Another generational buying opportunity. And people are equating that to now, even though we are much, much higher than those two periods, but we have fallen so much, and there is so much FUD out there. Are we at that point right now? Is that 17K bottom, or is it lower, right? Or maybe we are on our way to recovery already. I mean, there's a lot of still speculation. No one really knows, right? But this person kind of laid out some of the important levels. Right now, 16K is slightly below that. 17K is the moving average of 50%, which is important, right? 14K, 2019 echo bobble top. So these are previous support and levels, right? 12.2K Celsius liquidation. A lot of people seem to think that no matter how low Celsius brings their average down for liquidation, that must hit before we recover, right? That is at the 12,000 level. And then 10,000 level is a key resistance, because we were hovering below 10,000 for a long, 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 long time before we finally broke it. And then once we broke it, we headed up pretty fast, right? So these are some important levels. Do I think we're going to go to any of these levels at this point? I think it's very, very unlikely, especially the 10,000. Extremely unlikely. 12,000, I say that's unlikely. 14K, 16K, I think it's unlikely, although I recognize we did fall to 17K not too long ago. So can we go back to 17K and 16K? It's right around there. Even 14K, I don't see it. But right now, with all this FUD that's going on, right, and still macro stuff we have to worry about, and geopolitical stuff with Russia and how they're not too happy with what's going on with NATO and stuff, right? It's possible, but Again, I think it's unlikely. And the strategy doesn't change. The strategy doesn't change. No one knows where it's going to go, right? But when things are down this much, especially for Bitcoin, right, it's a buying opportunity. And that's what I'm doing. I'm continuing to stack sats and DCAing. And I know we're going to get through this. But right now, it's definitely hard. I just covered not only all the FUD I just covered, but just for markets alone, U.S. markets, the NASDAQ has never seen 6 months with this kind of horrible negative performance in its history. And you have to go back to 1960s to see a six-month period where the Dow went down this much. So it's absolutely horrible out there. But Bitcoin is still strong, and holders are not going to stop holding a DCA. And here's an extreme holder, right? But nevertheless, he is a holder, and he is DCAing. The third largest Bitcoin whale address, who holds 132,000 Bitcoins now. He was just holding about 127,000. He added about 5,000 Bitcoins. And you can see, nonstop DCAing, right? Just literally like almost every day. Every day, every 2 days, another 200, 300, 500, 200, 300, 800, 600. He's been stacking sats more and more as we hold at these levels, right? This is why Bitcoin will get through pretty much anything. Because of long-term holders, because of people who truly believe in what Bitcoin's all about and will continue to stack sats forever, despite how low it may go. And the lower it does go, the better the buying opportunity, right? So there are definitely a lot of whales that are still stacking, and not just sats, for ETH too. I mean, Sentiment posted this about how ETH's price has declined 39% over a course of a few months, yet the addresses holding anywhere from 100 to 100,000 ETH have stacked ETH. And you could see that green arrow, right? So there's a lot of people that are taking advantage, not just panic selling, although there's a lot of people that are panic selling. But the smart money, the big money, the ones that may be pulling the strings, they're the ones that keep stacking and stacking and stacking. All right. Now, other good news, Mexico, maybe third country to make Bitcoin legal tender. I know there's challenges, but if this happens, absolutely huge. But there are many that are still pro-Bitcoin. They believe in Bitcoin. Despite Bitcoin's drop from top, a lot of countries' fiat currencies have dropped a lot more due to inflation and hyperinflation. So there are still many countries that are looking to adopt Bitcoin. This is very early, but still, from a country perspective, we're still very, very early, right? And then as for other things, here's one. Alex Kruger posted this about volume. And generally speaking, when you have a huge red candlestick or a huge red bar of sell volume, that usually equates to a bottom. So going back to 2020, you could see the COVID crash of 2020. You could see the midterm crash of 2021. And look at where we are now. It's pretty obvious. You see this huge spike for sell, obviously sell volume, right? And then afterwards, that's recovery mode. And what are we seeing now? We're seeing that huge spike. A lot of it is due to the FUD. A lot of it is due to the Real Capital. A lot of it is due to the lending companies, right? But yeah. So if you're looking at that, does that mean we're at a bottom? Maybe. We don't know. But the strategy stays the same. You continue forward. You continue to stack sats. Have patience and focus on the future. All right. That's all I had to say. If you look at CoinMarketCap, just to refresh really quick, I mean, I say this a lot, but I do think this is very encouraging. And that is big BTC dominance. I don't think a lot of people focus on BTC dominance, but the fact that BTC dominance has not risen up crazily, which it always does. During bear markets, during major corrections, BTC dominance always flies up. And we have seen periods where it's as high as 70%, right? People flock to Bitcoin when there's uncertainty. And right now, that's not happening. The altcoins are actually still holding strong. And not only that, there are periods now where you see altcoins hold stronger than Bitcoin. And that's because there's just a lot of forced liquidations right now. There's a lot of talks about how Three Arrows Capital, you know, and what's going on with them, they're forced to liquidate, right? And there's many other companies that have exposure to them and that may have taken out a huge loan. They're forced to liquidate. And most of it is Bitcoin. And that is why you're starting to see Bitcoin actually sell off more than the alts right now. I mean, it's generally speaking, this never happens. When you have major fear, major corrections, it's always the alts that bleed out way more than Bitcoin, right? And from what we've seen, that has been true. But if you look at, you know, just to show you an example, and Ethereum is part of it too. But if you look at last 60-day, Bitcoin is down about 50%, which is horrible. I know it's horrible, but you look at BNB down 44%, Cardano down 43%, right? So there are a lot that are not down that much. Uniswap down 30%, FTX down 36%, Stellar down 37%, right? So there are a lot that are still, they're down, but they're not down as much as Bitcoin. And normally, that never happens. That never, ever, ever happens. But it shows you that right now, we could be seeing these forced liquidations of Bitcoin and Ethereum by these big guys because of what's going on, right? But regardless, I think that's encouraging that there's not mass panic. Not everyone is selling off every altcoin right now, right? Because then we'll see Bitcoin dominance come right back up to 70% like previous corrections. All right, let's do some Q&A. Completely random question. What chair are you using? This is like a gaming chair from Costco. I saw this. This is like a year ago. So you could probably find it still at Costco. It's pretty comfortable. Poor Jeb McCaleb, he'll no longer be dumping 7 million XRP every day in a few weeks. Yeah, I did read about that. A lot of the sell pressure from XRP came from Jeb McCaleb, who hates XRP and Ripple. So maybe with him stop selling, XRP would do a little better. I don't know. With possible dangers of KuCoin, there is not many options to store real degen coins. Trust Wallet, MetaMask, Killian Gas, any suggestions? Yeah, you just have to find. I mean, a lot of the universal wallets, like Trust Wallet or Coinbase Wallet or whatever, you know, they're meant to store ERC-20 stuff, Binance stuff, Solana stuff. But a lot of the random ones, yeah, you just have to keep it on exchange or find a native wallet from that project. That's really your only options. I mean, there are different various wallets that store various things, but you know, there's no one universal wallet that stores everything. So it is what it is. But right now, it's better to be safe than sorry. Like Ledger, you know, I know a lot of people are getting into Ledger. I think they're fantastic. Treasure, fantastic. I'm but limited on crypto. I started playing, finally, yesterday, I started playing with this Arculus wallet that I got from Bitcoin 2022. It's pretty simple. It's not a cold wallet though. It's integrated with your mobile phone with this NFC card. So there's a lot of options out there, but if you play around with them, you realize there's not one solution that encompasses all the crypto like these exchanges, which offers, you know, their own wallets everywhere. But you just have to be creative and utilize multiple wallets. Thoughts on a new Minion movie? I actually did watch that with my kids. I fell asleep halfway. So I guess if you're a kid, you'll enjoy that, but not adults, I don't think. If Coinbase goes bankrupt, would Coinbase wallet be safe? Yeah, it's a non-custodial wallet, so yes. Let's see here. What's your opinion on Pi Cycle theory? It's about to cross. I mean, there's a lot of models like the Pi Cycle. You know, if you look at what has happened before versus what's happening now, right? There are a lot of models that say that we are at bottom, that we are about to cross, right? Like Nuple, HODL, Wave. There's so many out there that say that, yeah, we're about to cross, right? So like I've been saying, I think we're a lot closer. No, I know we're a lot closer to bottom than we are to top, because top is infinite. So, you know, we just don't know. With the current macro environment, people worried about recession and all that stuff. Are those models going to hold true or are they going to be off, right? But right now, they're looking still like they look reliable. They're not like way off, right? So, let's see. We have been in recession ever since we can't afford to fix McDonald's ice cream machines. There's a big, big controversy over that. I think a lot of McDonald's franchisees are going to sue over that. Let's see. Where do you see Solana NFTs in 3 years? I don't know. Right now, NFTs just it's tough to be in NFTs, right? Obviously, with crypto being weak, who's going to be excited about NFTs? I saw Lamborghini, I think, was trying to sell some exclusive one-on-one NFT or something of their new Countach, and there was no bidders. Like right now, it's just horrible for NFTs. So NFTs that have use case, like a use case, will survive. The ones that are just basically like a collection, I don't know if they will. Maybe the big ones. Scooby-Doo. I don't know if that's how you say it, but I have a lot of respect for Steve Ehrlich because he personally helped me recover some lost BTC when I first opened my Voyager account. Okay. Not to say that he's not a bad guy. Or not to say he's not a good guy, right? But he probably regrets some of the decisions he has made. I was trying to see him. I saw him at Bitcoin 2022. I was trying to talk to him, but he was too busy. But yeah. Edmund, you're a great guy. Thanks for being so dedicated. I appreciate that. Thoughts on Celsius recovery proposals? They're all from one guy that's basically saying that they need to like come up with new tokens, you know, to try to recover whatever they lost. I'm not a fan of that. I'm not a fan of companies that's going under to just create a new token and expect people to buy into it and somehow forget about, you know, what has happened. So I'm not a fan of that. Another options look like basically they're going to sell to someone and hopefully they negotiate that the depositors will be able to withdraw. I don't know who's going to be giving them that much money. Would you agree that Nexo is in a better position? There's no exposure. They're over-collateralized and fully backed. That's what they say, bar me. But it's the same thing with BlockFi. BlockFi was over-collateralized. And their exposure with Three Arrow Capital, they said it was like $50 million. That didn't cause anything to happen with them. It's the withdrawals that is causing major issues for these projects. I'm pretty sure Nexo has seen some major withdrawals come out too. So yeah, they could be a better position, but I don't know if CeFi is going to survive, right? Like centralized finance, centralized lending. I just don't know if it's going to survive. I think it's dead. I don't think anyone's going to trust them in the future. Thoughts on 3,000 limits withdrawals on crypto.com. Is that new? Because I didn't hear about that. I don't know what the withdrawal limit before was on crypto.com. But if they're starting to limit withdrawals, I mean, obviously that's not good. I'll have to do more research into that. I have a significant amount of data on Binance, waiting for ledger support. You're going to have to use one of the other wallets, man, from CADEX. You know, they have a mobile wallet coming out. They have a browser wallet. They have the other wallet they already came out with. I forgot what it is. Zelcore or something like that. You're going to have to use one of those wallets if you want to get off Binance. Me personally, like I said about Coinbase, I think it's very unlikely to go under, right? But be careful. And same thing with Binance. I think it's very, very unlikely Binance will go under, but be careful. But with those two, I'm thinking, yeah, it's very unlikely to go under. Error to the Ron, be careful buying ledgers and treasures off eBay and Amazon. Go to official sites. That's a good warning because it's true. Because there are resellers on Amazon and eBay that will open it up and basically install malware, or they'll try to like set it up and basically write down the private key and then repackage it and ship it. I mean, there's a lot of stuff you could do, I guess. It's not likely, but there's been reports of that. So if you're going to be buying a hardware wallet, get it straight from the manufacturer. Okay, don't try to get it from like Amazon or eBay. Any promo codes for Ledger? No. I don't have any promo codes, but they always run promotions. And I am affiliate, so of course you could use my link below. But really, you know, I hear good things about a lot of wallets out there. Beastly tendencies, thank you. Are there risks with peg coins? Say if something happens to Binance. I don't know. Yeah, there is, I would think. I don't know what the implications will be. Baby Jane Gunter, I appreciate I was able to help you get things off of Voyager before it's too late. Is Vauld in trouble? No. They're still in my description, but I don't know if they're I don't know their circumstances. Last time I checked, they were still doing fine, but they did say that there was a massive amount of withdrawals. Basically, any lending project probably has massive withdrawals. But right now, their withdrawals still open, so I changed my USDT to BUSD. It's backed by Paxos, but what would happen if Binance went bankrupt? BCP 20 stops working and BUSD worthless. Well, BUSD is backed by Paxos, so most likely Paxos would still allow you to interchange. But Binance Smart Chain is not controlled by Binance. Despite what people think, there's a lot of validators out there. So even Binance goes under, the chain should still be up, theoretically. But yeah. Do you think Gemini will go under? I have not heard anything about Gemini. I think they're relatively safe too. They had to go through a lot to get their BIT license in New York. Not every exchange could get a BIT license. Very little exchanges gotten their BIT licenses, and they were one of the first ones to do so. So I'm assuming that they're okay. That part of the requirements of, you know, maintaining that BIT license is to, you know, do regular audits and make sure security is top notch and all this stuff. So I generally think that Gemini should be okay. Although they did offer passive rewards too, right? And they did have their own program called Lend, I think, like that. but it was through a third party. They even said it as much. So I don't know if they have any exposure to that. Binance buys FTX. Binance probably has enough money, but FTX is just way too big at this point. So they have plenty of money, but it still makes me wonder how they got so much money and how they're able to do what they're doing right now. Coinbase is expanding to Europe. I just covered that recently. Fufu, I can't help you with that advice. You have to decide for yourself. Zilliqa seems to be flying under radar. Do they have any real utility? Marco, I don't think they're flying under radar at all. They are what they are. And there's many L1s that are in competition with them. How many of the top 100 crypto tokens do you think will die? In a top 100? I don't know. Well, top 100, if the ones die, it gets replaced with other ones, right? But even going all the way down, you know, there's so many early stage ones in here. I don't think they're going to die. You know, we could compare this list, let's say, 4 years from now, and many will be off the top 100. They won't die, but this has become irrelevant and not popular. But like, there's really nothing in here that really stands out. Other than, I'd say a few like Tron. I don't trust Justin at all. He may screw things up. Like Leo, which is a token created by Bitfinex. You know, and if somehow Bitfinex and Tether goes belly up, Leo will go belly up. But outside of those, I mean, you're going down like... exchange tokens, if somehow KuCoin or Gate.io, they go under, maybe they're going to be gone. It's funny that Terra Classic, despite being at 6 cents instead of $1, it's still in the top 100 once again. That's kind of crazy if you think about it. Like Waves, Stepin, I don't trust these projects. So, you know, I would say maybe at most, I would say 15 out of 20 in the top 100 will be gone. But I don't think they'll be dead. I think realistically, the projects that could die completely, probably more like 5 to 10 in the top 100, not in the entire thing. I mean, you're talking about, if you're looking at an entire space of 20,000, probably 99.5% of that will die over a long haul. Jeff, thank you. Can Stepin come back to life? I don't know. I've never liked that project. I never liked it. Didn't trust it, and I still don't. So I don't know. I don't know. Okay. I think that's it. I'll let you guys get back to your weekend, 4th of July weekend. So a lot of FUD going on, a lot of stuff that I've been covering for weeks now. And it seems to be getting worse. There does seem to be people that are spreading more FUD. Hopefully they are just FUD and they're just meant to scare people, and we're not going to see more of what's happening with Voyager and Celsius, right? But I do think that there's a coordinated attack right now. And it could be because there are some people, or the ones that's trying to pull the strings, are trying to buy at low, low, low prices, right? But ultimately, I'm staying strong. Hopefully you guys do too, because we will get through this. We always do. And you got guys like this third largest whale that continues to DCA and stack sats. because they also believe. And this is ultimately the reason why Bitcoin will come back up and continue further, because there's so many people that believe in it and will never give up on it. All right. So stay strong, my friends. Enjoy your day. Enjoy your weekends. I'll probably stream tomorrow, same time, 11:30 a.m., but not on Monday. We will see. Unless there's breaking news or something like that, I'll create a video. All right, guys. Smash a like, subscribe to the channel. Stay safe out there. Secure your crypto and have a good one. All right. Bye-bye.